It certainly was a shocker of a day to be in the car, but luckily we were prepared for the deluge.
And that's thanks to the wonder that is weather forecasting. But it hasn't always been that way.
We've always tuned in to watch the weather.
Tēnā koutou, kia ora.
That was the fine art of forecasting circa 1970. Forget fancy graphics and rain radars, we're talking magnetic maps and pointers. And if you were really fancy, a chalkboard.
A very tightly wound up storm.
They don't just look funny, those old weather forecasts were often totally wrong. These days, things have changed. A 5-day forecast today is as accurate as a 1-day forecast was in the 1980s. So we know when the big wet is going to turn into the big bad.
And we're joined now by NIWA climate scientist Nava Fadaev. Great to see you, Nava. Tell us, what's made forecasting more accurate?
Well, two big reasons. The first one being is satellites, and they've really increased the amount of observations we have right around the Earth, even in really remote areas. So that's giving us a lot of dense data that we can use for forecasting. And the other massive reason is supercomputing. We wouldn't be able to have modern forecasting without it. The NIWA supercomputer can do 3,000 trillion calculations per second, which is a huge amount of maths. When this type of forecasting was first conceived about a century ago, Lewis Fry Richardson thought that you'd need about 64,000 mathematicians in a room to crunch the numbers to produce a real-time forecast, and he was actually way under, so kind of the whole population of Rotorua. So luckily we don't have to do that. Thank you, supercomputers.
Nava, I spend a lot of time on the weather apps. Why do we see such different forecasts from different agencies?
Well, that's a great question, Jeremy, and just like you can't recreate a KFC chicken, every forecaster has their own secret sauce, so different ingredients going in there, different outcomes. You might get the similar flavour, but it's not going to be exactly the same. The other big reason is model resolution, so how coarse that resolution is. And for some global data providers, if they want to provide a forecast for the whole world, they have to compromise a little bit. You might be getting the same forecast that covering quite a large area, whereas the modelling that we do here at NIWA is much higher resolution, so you're getting a lot more granularity, detail, and accuracy.
And what other gains are expected in forecasting in the near future?
Yeah, so in terms of weather forecasting, we've got a lot of our gains already, and where the computing power is going now is ensemble modelling. So instead of running your model and getting just one outcome, we run that same model multiple times. So at NIWA we run that model 18 different times, and we see how that outcome diverges. So imagine if you're playing Who Wants to Be a Millionaire, and you get the chance to ask the crowd what their opinion is. If they all kind of answer one answer there, it's like the ensemble model. If you're getting all your models showing you the same thing, you're going to have more confidence in that. So that's where a lot of the forecasting effort is now, is looking at ensemble modelling, just because we have that supercomputing power to be able to do that. And the other big one is in seasonal forecasting. So not a weather forecast, but what's happening in the next 2 to 3 to 6 months, more of a bigger climate outlook. And that's where we're getting a lot of our gains in accuracy at the moment.
Nava, will we ever achieve 100% accuracy?
If I'm forecasting 5 minutes out, I reckon I can achieve that. But ultimately, the atmosphere is chaotic. And so the further out we look, even with increased supercomputers and things like that, there's probably going to be a bit of uncertainty there. So I'm not sure about that 100%.
Thanks, Nava. Great to talk to you.
You too.